Hello, everybody. I'm here today with Rob Ichelson from Canaphem. I met Rob first a couple of years back, more than a couple, through the Do It in Durham week. And he started coming out to our sessions, and then we worked with Rob on his business. But love him to bring us up to date about where he's at right now with his business. Rob, give us a quick update.
Well, it's been quite a 4 years as we've experienced, I would call it exponential growth. We went from a company when I first started with just me, with great ideas and a good, you know, solid plan of where we're going, to a company now that has four full-time, including myself, and about 20 part-time in total.
That's amazing.
So we've grown, we're doubling sales on average every year, which is very exciting.
Yes.
And just growing.
And I'll get into that a little bit more detail so people can find out about you. As many of you know, BACD strives to be the go-to business resource for businesses in Durham region. We are one of 53 centers in Ontario that are here to serve entrepreneurs. And our mission is that entrepreneurs we serve achieve business success, just like Rob. Rob's mission always was, from the minute I met him, to be a $5 million company. And, you know, when you decide that you want to be a $5 million company, it's a very different growth strategy than you would use than a company that's a bit smaller than that. And there's nothing wrong with either or. It's just that his vision was to be that. His vision, his mission was to always embody that $5 million company. So I always like to use Rob, actually, as an example in many of our workshops, because he made that decision to be that big company. And so everything he builds around him, his team, his processes, his tools and software that he uses, is to actually get to that point of being that company and then to grow beyond that. Right, Rob?
Hey, that's the goal, is to grow beyond and branch out all over the world.
Exactly. And I'd love to tell you to tell me your story. What inspired you to actually start your own business?
You know, I went through a transition in life. I was a paramedic for many years, and unfortunately was one of the unlucky 30%, or some might call it lucky, that got sick, developed post-traumatic stress injury, and couldn't continue in the career that I absolutely love and was passionate with, and had to kind of come up with something else to do with my life. So I'm not the one to sit around and just collect a pension and sit on the couch and watch TV all day. I had to do something, and I'm not really good at working for other people. So I had to figure out something I could do for me. And that's what gave birth to Canaphem. I'm asked all the time, you know, how did I come up with the plan? How did I come up with it? And the true answer is, it just came to me one day sitting in front of my desk, and on a spur of a whim, I registered the company name. I came up with the name, registered the name, and as they say, the rest is history.
That's a wonderful story. Tell us the name, because I know you and I talked about it right in the beginning. Tell people what the name is.
So Canaphem is our short form. It's our operating name. It's a lot easier than our real name. The real name is the Canadian Academy for Pre-Hospital and Emergency Medicine Incorporated. That's a tongue twister. It's huge. It means a lot to me. It doesn't mean a lot to my clients. And so we operate as Canaphem.
Which means a lot, I think, because it sounds medical to me in some way.
Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned a little bit about your journey of how to get to where you are today. Tell us just a little bit about the types of things. I put a little bit on the slide, but I'd love people to just find out a little bit more about the services that Canaphem offers.
Yeah, so Canaphem is it's almost a 360 solution for health and safety. Not almost, it is. When I started the business, my plan was to train, if you'll remember, to train moms and local people in CPR, and that's changed. That's not what we do anymore. So Canaphem is a very niche, unique kind of company. We deal with businesses only, and typically deal with companies 50 or 100 or more employees. Some of our clients have hundreds of thousands of employees worldwide. And our whole thing is that we provide a whole slew of services. So it starts with our consulting division, which is a growing division. And in that division, we go out and we provide health and safety solutions for companies. So we go in and we help them establish their health and safety policies, procedures. We look at their policies and procedures. We help revamp their policies and procedures. And then we also help them create emergency response plans, evacuation plans. So anything health and safety planning is really that division of the company. And we have a training division. And our training division started off as where our roots are in first aid and CPR training, but it's expanded. So now we do first aid CPR training. We do advanced response training, advanced life support training, but we also do health and safety training. So things like health and safety awareness, WMIS, which is now a different name, but WMIS training, psychological first aid, mental health first aid. So any of the health and safety training programs that companies need or want, we provide. And we have our, within that division, we also come up with customized training programs. One of our most recent ones is working outdoors. So it's a course that will help companies train their people on how to effectively and safely work outdoors. The next division of our company is our equipment and supply division. And we supply everything from first aid kits to EpiPens to defibrillators to health and safety solutions, all at a reasonable price and designed to help them save money. Our next division would be our paramedic division, which is probably one of our newest divisions, where we actually have our paramedic staff go out and provide special event coverage at events all over Ontario. And that's a new division that just started up. And then we have our software. We've developed software. It's proprietary and unique for health and safety. So a whole 360 solution, if you will, for health and safety within the industry or within industry.
So tell us, how did you know your company was going to grow this big?
I didn't. I just had a goal and a vision, and it's been tough and it's been hard work. But I think when you have a unique offering that solves problems that people have in a economically acceptable way, people will gravitate to you and your company. And then, you know, one thing will lead to another. But I had a plan and a vision, but I wasn't sure if we were ever going to get there. And we've just sort of ridden the wave, and it's been up and down, as you can imagine, but sort of just going.
Tell me about, I mean, I know when I first met you, it literally was first aid training and some CPR training and then the defibrillators. And I, from just what you said, as you kept adding to your business, do these opportunities present to your, to you, or do you, when you're out there in the market, you're noticing where the gaps are and you're taking them on?
So in some of it, it's been doing SWOT analysis or gap analysis of both ourselves and our clients. A lot of it's been getting feedback from our clients and what their unique struggles are, and then coming up with solutions for that struggle. And some of it's actually been listening to our staff and hearing what they want to do and putting together programs that maybe won't make us a lot of money, but keep them happy, engaged. And if your employee, if your team is happy, if they're engaged and they want to work hard, then you're going to grow. So, you know, our event paramedic division, that's how that started. The staff came to me and said, we want to provide paramedic. We want our service to be able to be used at events. And they helped me by writing their own business case. They sold me on it, and we started that division up.
And that's wonderful. Tell me, what do you see as the coming trends for your business over the next couple of years?
So, you know, our plan is to, we just finished doing, or are in the process of doing our five-year plan. But our plan is to have offices open, one East, one West, and then Central Canada, as well as our UK and international operations expanding. So ultimately our goal over the next 5 years is to grow the business so we have multiple locations in Canada. And then abroad. That's our plan.
So tell me about, I know that you went to the UK last year, and is that an office there now?
No, so we have a remote, it's not an office, I mean, it's virtually remote, but we have clients over in the UK that fly us over two or three times a year, and we bring our team over, and we provide training in the UK. What's really exciting this year is we're adding Ireland and Scotland to the mix. So last year we stuck strictly to the north and south of England. And this year we're starting in December actually. So I guess it's the same year. We're going to have teams going over to Ireland, to Glasgow, Scotland, and then back to Manchester and London.
Very cool. So here's a question I have for you. Why would they choose you over the companies that they already have in this, that have in the UK? Like, what's different about Canaphem?
So Canaphem is the only company in the world that can provide multi-country certifications. So we provide certifications in just about every single country in the world. That took a year of planning and development, negotiating, and really working hard to be able to get that. So we offer certification in our programs that is valid and accepted almost every country in the world. And there's no other company that we are aware of, and I always preface it with that because there may be one that we don't know of, but that we're aware of that can offer that. So when you think of organizations that need people to have multi-country training and certification, we're the go-to company for that. There really is nobody else out there that can do it. Now, as our competition hears what we've done, eventually they're going to figure it out and they'll do it, but we hope to be well ahead of the game. So that's why.
That's why, okay. That makes sense, especially for a company, say like a large multinational like Facebook. They would want their Joint Health and Safety Committee here to kind of have the same training all around the world if they could, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, it's also good. We do a lot of work with staffing companies who are sending staff to come and work in Canada and the US, and they require training in Canada and the US. Well, if we can train them before they come here, and train them at home, economically, that's actually cheaper for the organization to pay for one of our team or two of our team to fly over, put us up in hotels, pay our food, than it is to fly everybody over here, find central places to train them and then train them. And how we won the contract is by having that multinational certifications.
Right, very good. What about, do you do any training virtually at all or online, or is it all face-to-face?
Yeah, so we do have some courses online. Majority of them are not. Majority of them are in class, but things like our WIMIS training, our working outdoors training, and some of our psychological first aid training pieces are taught and available online. But most of our courses, 95%, are in-class courses.
I know that you've been through so many trials and tribulations as a business owner. What piece of advice would you give to anybody who wants to become an entrepreneur?
Ask lots of questions. Okay. Learn. Make mistakes, and don't be afraid to fail, because at the end of the day, you learn by your failures, you don't learn by the successes. So don't be afraid to fail.
Are there any failures you're willing to share with us?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we've had staff come and go. I call that failures if you don't keep people around. Certainly our cash flow is a regular failure for us. So we've lost contracts that we wanted to get, allowing people to stray you in different directions. But if you stay true to yourself and you stay true to what you do and you learn from those errors, and I don't call them, I mean, they're not failures, they're errors or misguided methods. If you learn from them, all that happens is you correct those problems and move forward. So
fair enough.
I don't know that I would actually call them failures as opposed to learning opportunities.
Right. Awesome. Thank you. To follow on from that question, what would you say the top three skills an entrepreneur needs to be successful?
The word that comes to mind is a Yiddish word, and it says gumption. Okay. Gumption is guts. It's having lots of guts. That's the number one skill. But the other skill that I had to learn and I'm still learning is financial literacy. And that is not as easy as it sounds, but reaching out to places like Business Development Canada, BDC, there's programs out there to teach you. Financial literacy is a big one. And I think that's just going to be the same for all business owners. The other thing I'd say is just be willing to make mistakes and follow your dream. Set a dream, set a course and go. And learn how to, I'm trying to think of the right way to say it, but it's not necessarily a business plan, but a working document that will help you stay focused on where you're going.
Right, so have a plan, right?
Have a plan, right? It doesn't have to be an in-depth plan. You know, our plan, our current one we're working on now, it's about 7 pages. It's not a huge plan.
You don't need more than that.
You don't need more. You just need something that you can look at and go, this is where we're going to be in 1 month, 6 months, a year, 2 years, 5 years. Yeah.
So to follow on from our relationship that we've had, how would you say BACD has helped you with your business?
Well, certainly in the beginning, not knowing where or how to do any of this, the the seminars I took were invaluable, but the one-on-one mentoring that we did has really been quite helpful. It grounds you, and it allows you to have somebody to run ideas by and to give you honest feedback that you may not want to hear at times, but I think that's important. And it's just something to keep you motivated to keep going.
Yeah, that's good to hear. Thank you. What key activities would you recommend that business owners invest their time in? I know you mentioned that the skills was like financial literacy, but are there any other activities that they should invest their time in?
Yeah, so networking is key. You know, if you're not out networking, you're not making alliances with people who might buy your services. But networking isn't the answer, because you can go and network until you're blue in the face and not sell a thing. You have to network in the right place to the right people. So the first thing you have to determine is, what kind of business are you? Are you business to consumer? Are you business to business? What is the type of business, if you're business to business, you're going after? What's that demographic look like? And where are those people? Mm-hmm. Because you can go, and I did it for many years. I went to every networking event you could possibly think of. And it was only until about 2 years in that I finally figured out who my client really was. And now I only go to those networking events that my clients are going to be at. Because going to networking events that make you feel good but don't have clients or potential clients there is essentially wasting your time and money. And if you're wasting your time and money, you're not growing. So it's not that you shouldn't be going where you like going, but your time is valuable. And there's only 24 hours in the day, and you need 30 hours to run a business. So you got to pick where you network. But if you don't network, if you're not out meeting people, you're not out putting yourself out there, you will not be successful. You will not be able to develop your business. It's not as simple as, I got an idea, and away I go.
Okay, so networking is a key activity. What other ones do you think for your business growth?
For us, it's been trade shows. Okay. Has been a key activity. Learning as much as you can, reading various books on, I'm not a salesperson. I don't know sales. So what have I been doing? I've been reading books on sales, right? What are they going to tell me? They tell you how to sell, right?
Yeah, I do find them very valuable myself. I'm always reading books around business related books. So talking about that, what business related book has inspired you the most? Is there a bunch?
I wouldn't say there is a book, but rather a type of book.
Yeah.
Current, real life, realistic, and authentic programs that teach you how to sell and teach you how to manage a business. Those are the ones that I found really helpful. And not necessarily books that you get at Chapters or the library. Some of them have been online books. Some of them are short story books.
Very cool.
I wouldn't say there's any one. I get asked that pretty regularly. What book would you recommend? And one of the key things is that I found is people are always recommending books to me. And they would swear up and down that those are the best books in the world, and I'd read them and I don't agree with them. So you got to find the ones that are meaningful to you and speak to you. I'm a science-based person. I like science. I study science. And what we do is scientific. So finding scientifically sound books for me is what really helps me, because then I can take them more for what they're trying to say. So know what your type of reading is.
Yeah. Very good point. I find that for me too. It's like it needs to speak to me. I need to be able to relate to what it is I'm listening to or reading. And that really helps me in taking in that information for sure. So I appreciate that. And I do love that you mentioned networking, because I find networking is one of the most important activities you can do for your business, but also invest your time in. But of course, you need to invest it in the right place. You know, you mentioned that you didn't know who your target market was. I would hazard a guess that most people are not exactly sure of who their target markets are. Not in those first few years. You're still honing, you're really trying to find out who is it that buys. And I can see from when we first met that you've totally changed your target market, because now you mentioned it right at the beginning. You were very clear about, this is the size business that we're going after. And when I first met you, I would say the reason you were networking where you were was because you thought your target market was those one customer, you know, one customer at a time, small. So I think being very smart, you've moved up in terms of like gone to the bigger businesses, more money, and also more of a full 360 solution that you can offer. And, you know, then it's economically viable for both parties, right? So I love mm-hmm. that. What do you think separates you from the competition?
Integrity, yeah. Honesty, and a desire to work hard. You know, and authenticity. I think that's another big one. When you're an expert in your field, and I think myself and my team are all experts in the field, and you, pardon my expression, but you don't BS people. You just straight up and you tell them the way it is. You just, this is reality. You know, I'm going to save you money and here's how I'm going to back it up. One of the things I say, and I wouldn't call it an elevator pitch, but I guess it is an elevator pitch. I always say, and I start the conversation with, our company's different than every other's. And I forward it right after by saying, and everybody says that, and here's how we really are different, right? Yeah. And then living by it. So,
yeah.
I think the key is, and the reason companies buy from us is we're authentic, we're honest. If we don't have the answer, we find the answer for them. It's willing to work for them and work to make their lives easier. So we solve problems that they have, and we solve it in a reasonable method. I think that's why companies work with us.
Great.
I hope that's why.
Do you believe there's some sort of formula or pattern for an entrepreneur to be successful?
No. I think the it's that gumption, that guts to just make mistakes. To not be told that you can't do it. You know, financial, I'll use that as an example. There's many banks, every bank is likely going to say no to you. And that's okay. It's fine. If you're all, there's ways to make it. And just having the guts to not be afraid to fail. Because if you do, you start again. It's not the end of the world.
Very true. You mostly self-funded your venture, didn't you?
Absolutely. Yeah. That's a challenge, self-funding, but
yes,
for blood, sweat, tears, and money.
Very much so. Very much so. What makes you continue day after day?
I have mouths to feed.
It's not
just my staff. It's not just my kids. It's all of them, right? That's why it's, you know, there's mouths to feed every day. Somebody's got to get fed. So, you know, you got to continue.
Someone's relying on you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Same place, just with more people.
Okay. And you're fired up about that? You're quite excited?
Scared and excited at the same time.
Yeah. How do you manage that fear?
I wish I had an answer. I don't. Because what are the options? Right? Like,
the options are that what you're choosing every day is to be in your own business, to strive for that mission that you have, right? And to, like, mm-hmm. failure is not an option. I remember you telling me that. Like, quitting the business is not an option because I really love what I'm doing.
Right. If you have something you're passionate about and you care about, then you'll be successful with it. And there's areas that you're not going to like doing. This morning I was doing the finances in the business. I hate it. It's probably the part of the business I hate the most is the finances. But it has to be done.
Why do you hate it? What's there to hate about it?
It's mind-numbing work. It's numbers. It's just sitting and playing with numbers. And I'm not a numbers guy. I'd rather be out talking to people and doing things. So I don't enjoy it, but it's a part of the business. It has to get done.
Right.
No different than cold calls. Nobody likes cold calls. I've never met anyone who loves cold calls. But, you know, 50 people say no, but one says yes. And it's the one that says yes that makes it worthwhile and gets you fired up.
Have you figured it out that it's quite the numbers game, really?
it is a numbers game. We average 100 to 150 cold calls a day in the business. We don't outsource it. It's our own staff. We do it ourselves. We get everyone doing it. And we find that of that, 30% approximately translates into some form of conversation, and 10 to 15% of that will close into a sale. So it's a numbers game.
Statistics, because then you always know what you're going to get, right?
Right. It's numbers. It's 7 to 10 touch points before somebody will talk to you. There's a lot of science behind it. Believe the science. It's true.
I remember telling you that even like 4 years ago. I remember when we were doing your sales letters and we were coming up with, okay, we need to come up with 7 to 12 ideas of things to say to people every time we get a hold of them.
Right.
Because we need to have a system in place of like, how many times are we going to get hold of someone and talk to them? What the heck are we going to say to them every time?
And I'll talk to that really briefly. Getting the right technology is what's going to help you with that. We now use a CRM called HubSpot.
Good.
And HubSpot is probably the best. I've tried 4 or 5 different ones.
I remember.
And it costs money. It's expensive. It's not cheap. But if you get the right technology, you'll automate most of your sales cycle. And that's what we do. So, you know, an email goes out, a phone call goes out, another email goes out, another phone call comes out, a social media connection will happen on this day. And it seems monotonous, but it's incredible that these tools that are out there, use them. And that would be next to financial literacy. I would say that's my next biggest piece of advice is spend the money on the tools, but know which tools you need.
Right. But when you started out on Insightly and you did such a great job with it.
And Insightly is good, but it doesn't have that built-in sales cycle.
Not the same way. You have to do it yourself.
Right.
I find is actually more powerful on HubSpot. But
right.
Are you using the free version of HubSpot or you're paying?
No, we pay for it.
Yeah. It's worth it. I mean, I use Salesforce. I have it automated. You know, it's worth having those tools. And it's really hard when you're first starting out. For someone like me to tell businesses, you know what, it will be worth the money investing in one of those, because if you just don't have it, you don't have it. So you got to just take it baby steps at a time and, you know, grow from 101 to 201 to 301 in terms of software. But you're right. The tools are very important.
And I guess the other piece of advice I would give, and I'm probably straying a little bit, is when you think it's time to hire somebody, hire them. Right. And not everybody's going to work out. And that's okay too. But find people and delegate, let them do things.
Empower them.
Yeah.
Would you say that's one of your biggest challenges is just your staffing, keeping them engaged?
It's finding staff. Mm. It's finding people. We're trying to hire another 5 people right now. It's finding people. It's not keeping them engaged. It's finding staff. That's our challenge. Now we're unique in that they have to have certain qualifications for us to hire them. Mm-hmm. Finding them is the challenge.
Yeah, I would say that's the case with lots of people. And so now all of a sudden you've got to become competitive, right? With all the other employers that are out there.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it's the other employers. It's the volume of work you may or may not have for people. There's a lot of questions about whether people should be employees or contractors and what model works best for you. So staffing is a challenge.
Yes.
And don't skip out on that either. Get good advice from HR staff.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily have to have an HR staff person, but you need the advice from HR people.
Yeah. I know that was something you hired out right near the beginning, and you also hired out your accounting, which I think was smart, you know, to have an accounting service looking after you, and you're doing the basics but you're passing it on.
Right.
Very smart. It allows you to grow.
Well, it does. It allows you to grow, but you know, when you think about accounting staff, the mistake I made in the beginning was I allowed the accountant to do everything and didn't really question it. Now I can look at everything and I understand what I'm looking at. So, you know, keep the books yourself, but have somebody check your work.
Right.
And make sure you do check that work, because mistakes happen, and it's your money when the mistake happens.
It's your responsibility at the end of the day, right? You can't.
And that's why I say,
blame the accountant, but the CRA is not going to care.
They don't care. And same reason I say with the HR, until you're ready to do it on your own, get somebody who knows to help you with it. Because you will be amazed as you hire people, the stuff that will happen. It will blow you away, the things that happen. And without the right advice, the right knowledge, you will make significant mistakes. You can't be an expert in everything. So when you have complex things, you need to ask for help.
Good point. Good point. So talking about that, if anybody does need help in these, please reach out to BACD. We've got some experts on our network who can help you. And it is about, you know, I know we mentioned networking is important, but it's also networking to find suppliers and vendors and people who can help you in your business. Right, Rob?
Absolutely. And, you know, be reasonable with what you do, though.
Yeah.
Right. Don't take on too much inventory or not enough inventory. Don't rush out. We still work out of our office, but it's in a home.
Yeah.
And you know what? I remember once being told in our infancy that nobody will take you seriously if you're working out of a house. And I'll tell you, we are taken seriously. Likewise, I don't wear ties. I've never worn a tie. I don't wear a tie. I don't wear a suit. I'm currently wearing shorts and a t-shirt. And I had one person tell me, if you keep dressing like that, nobody's going to buy from you. I have Fortune 500 companies that are our clients. Right. They don't care. They're not looking at how you dress. Now, they don't want to see you dress like a slob, but they want to see that you're an honest person with integrity and that you act that way. So be true to yourself. Don't become something you're not.
Very true. Very, very true. And I think today, you can do business from anywhere in the world and you'll be taken seriously. It's how you portray yourself and your company, you know, and how those things look, I think.
And when a mistake happens, and it will, take absolute ownership and responsibility right away. And you'll keep your customers. They will be happy and they'll stay with you.
Very good point.
Excuses. Just come out and say, I'm new. I tell people all the time, I'm not a business person. I'm a paramedic. That's my background. I'm learning every day. And it's amazing. When you say that you want to learn, your clients will help teach you.
That's amazing. That's a good attitude to have, because it doesn't assume that you know more than somebody else. And then you put them at ease when they think of that, right? So Rob, thank you very much for your time. I know you're busy and you've got to get back to it, but I really appreciate it. It's been wonderful to watch your journey and to have you as a partner of BACD. And I know you've told people to come to us over the years and referred us. So we really are thankful that we have people like you in our corner, and we wish you the best of success in your business.
And thank you for all of your help. And we'll see where the next 4 years go and where we are. And I'm sure we'll get to do this again. But just to say, you know, BACD was a great help to us, and it can be a great help to anybody who's helping out. So, reach out and get that help and learn.
Thank you. I agree with you. Open mind, learning, very, very powerful. So thank you. Appreciate you being here with us today, and look forward to, speaking to you again. Take care.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.